Good evening. Let's call this meeting of the Champaign County Board to order. It's Thursday, April 20th, 2017. The time is 6:34. Roll call, please.
King. McGuire.
Here.
Michaels.
Here.
Mitchell.
Here.
Patterson.
Here.
Petrie.
Present.
Rector. Rosales.
Here.
Summers.
Here.
Tinsley.
Present.
Alex. Anderson.
Here.
Clemens.
Here.
Cowart. See. Cruz.
Here.
Esri.
Present.
Das.
Here.
Harper.
Here.
Hartke.
Here.
Heiser.
Here.
Weibel.
Here. We have a quorum. Instead of a prayer tonight, I'd ask that we have a moment of silence for two county board members who passed away recently, Lloyd Carter, of course, and also Richard Steigman, who served during the 1970s. So a moment of silence, please, for those two former county board members. Okay, Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Would the clerk please read the notice of the meeting?
Notice is hereby given that a regular meeting of the County Board, Champaign County, Illinois, will convene on April 20th, 2017 at 6:30 p.m. in the Lyle Shields Meeting Room, Brookings Administrative Center, 1776 East Washington Street, Urbana, Illinois, in said county for the purpose of allowing and ordering payments of claims against the county, receiving and acting upon reports of committees, and such other matters as may be brought before said meeting, which said meeting shall continue in session from day to day until the completion of said business.
Thank you. Seek approval of the agenda and addenda. Moved by Mr. Esri.
Second.
Second by Ms. Petrie. Mr. McGuire.
I'd like a motion to amend the agenda for three separate items, please. I got to start with two. One is on the agenda. And other business, adoption of resolution number 9901, honoring retired county board member John Jay, asking to move these to just after communications. Is that where we're starting? And then adding and moving the same like agenda item, other business presentation, honoring former county board member Lloyd Carter to the same location. And then third, having to do with the nursing home, which is a new item on the agenda, updating financial update and discussion, which is actually on the new listed agenda.
Yeah, number two.
Yeah.
On the white sheet.
On the white sheet.
I've been number two on the nursing home under new business.
Under new business.
Is there a second to that amendment?
Second.
Second by Mr. Goss. Discussion. See none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Vote on the main motion on the agenda. Any further discussion? See none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. We have an agenda. Next, item number six, resolution number 9898. Mr. McGuire, as caucus chair, would you like to make that motion, please?
Adoption of resolution number 9898, adoption of Brooks Marsh as a county board member of District 1 to fill the John Jay's unexpired term ending November 30th, 2018.
Second. Second by Ms. Michaels. Discussion. See none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Do your job, Ms. Clerk. Friday, May 5th at 9 o'clock a.m. in the morning. Committee of the Whole, Justice, Social Services, Policy, Personnel, Departments, and Finance on May 9th at 6:30. The regular county board meeting next month is on May 18th at 6:30. Public participation, we have a few tonight, 5 minutes each. First up is Victor Fuentes.
Victor Fuentes, 2305 Firethorn Lane, Champaign, Illinois. I've been working on this project for about a year. I partnered up with Ms. Tracy Lips, and we decided to convert one of her existing buildings into a place where we can hold events. We have transferred the building as it is. We have heard the concerns of the neighbors, and we have tried to address them to the best of my abilities. We have tried to go above and beyond as far as the CVA have given us some recommendations of the things that we needed to do in order for this to move forward. We have done those items. We have also have planted excessive trees to the east side of our property that were not asked for us. We actually planted some more towards the south side, closer to the street to block view or the anything that it would be not nice to see from the neighbors, as that was one of the concerns they had in the past. So I believe you have seen the agenda, so if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them the best that I can.
We do not allow discussion at this time, okay. But we may call you back later in the meeting.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Next is Mr. Bobby Johnson. You just turned it off.
Sorry.
There you go.
Okay. I thought it turned green. My name is Bobby Johnson. I'm also, I guess I'm the opponent or against the amending zoning ordinance for these Ellipse Fuentes property, the rezoning. And I will agree that Mr. Fuentes and Ms. Lips have added trees and have done certain things, but it was prior to what the zoning board had suggested that they did. The things that they had did, like the tree planting and the fixing up of the existing barn and stuff, the zoning board found out that they did. Then they went to the zoning board and asked for the permits and stuff when the zoning board had found out that they were trying to open up an event center and everything. And then they went to the zoning board and asked, for the permits and asked, then we, got into these meetings and everything like that. This is not something that any of the neighbors want. The neighbors did go through and sign the petition to go against this, so that's why we are here. We are here at the meeting that we're at now. Yes, there are some trees planted, which they have done on their own. It was not asked by the zoning board that they had done those on their own. Everything that they have done has been conceded to do on their own, not anything above and beyond what was, asked for them that would not have been in any stipulations or recommendations from the zoning board other than moving a parking lot that was out towards a public road. The parking lot had to be in some stipulations, had to be moved up towards the event center, up towards their house, other than towards where they had put it, towards a busy road. That's the only thing that had actually needed to be changed that the zoning board had recommended. Other than anything else they have done on their own that the zoning board hadn't recommended. So they haven't really conceded to anything that the zoning board, they haven't went above and beyond anything else. Like I said, the neighbors, you know, do not want this. They want to keep it agricultural. They do not want anything changed. That's why people live, you know, out in the country. They don't want the hustle and bustle of the cars and the traffic and, you know, the parties and, you know, they want the quietness and, you know, that's where we live and we want to keep it the agricultural district and not to have it changed into anything else because that's just welcoming, you know, more people and more businesses and everything like that. I think there is enough with these, you know, event centers, you know, coming, you know, around to, you know, the Champaign-Urbana area. There's three or four out there already that, you know, people can attend to and that type of thing. With the large parties and small business parties that they can have, you know, for this event center every day of the week. With the travel and, you know, business and, you know, country roads, you know, are not, you know, divided roads and, you know, what, 17 feet across, that, you know, kind of make it a little treacherous for, you know, people who are not used to driving in the country and that are unlit and, you know, especially with, you know, alcohol being served and in the evening hours and stuff. So we, myself and the neighbors who have signed the petition are still opposed to it. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next up is Ken Johnson.
Ken Johnson, 1751 County Road, 1850 North, just south of this proposed event center. And I want to follow what she just said. And they keep telling me that they've given them a lot of restrictions. But all this time, they have told them not to do things until they get it okayed. And they went ahead and done stuff. So what's, if they're not going to follow what they've been told through the zoning board, what's going to keep them to keep the go by these restrictions and stuff? I'll bet you right now they're supposed to not have anything during the harvest or planting, and I'll bet you right now they've got things planned for that. So, and what do they do when they do have go against the restrictions? Give them a letter and tell them, oh, don't do that again. I just don't trust these people, and that, you know, just none of the neighbors want this. That's all I've got to say.
Is that it?
Yes.
All right, thank you very much. Are there any other members of the public who wish to participate at this time? Okay, seeing none, let's close that. Let's move on to the consent agenda. Any items that you wish to take off the consent agenda? Moved to approve by Mr. Esri, a second by Mr. Hartke. No items to take off? Okay, let's have a roll call.
King. Yes. Marsh. Yes. McGuire. Michaels?
Yes.
Mitchell?
Yes.
Patterson?
Yes.
Petrie?
Yes.
Rosales?
Yes.
Summers?
Yes.
Tinsley?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Clemens?
Yes.
Cowart?
Yes.
Cruz?
Yes.
Esri?
Yes.
Goss?
Yes.
Harper?
Yes.
Hartke?
Yes.
Heiser?
Yes.
Weibel?
Yes. Motion carries. Next item is communications from board members. Are there any communications? Ms. Cowart?
You have a resolution number 977.
Yeah, hold on a second. Do we want to go ahead and move on that?
We'll just wait.
Sorry?
That's not a new resolution.
No, it's old one.
Yeah.
Let's wait on that. Let's hold off on that, Lorraine.
Mm-hmm.
Let's hold off on that, okay?
Okay.
Any other items to communicate? Okay, seeing none, let's move on to Mr. Jay first.
Yes.
Resolution honoring Mr. Jay.
We don't have Mr. Rose yet.
Hold on.
Is he here?
Yeah, he is here.
Hey, he's here.
Mr. McGuire, okay. You want to move
Thank
that?
You very much. I guess I'll start with a resolution, and obviously we're honoring Mr. Jay tonight and the service of all of our county board members that are retiring and really their families, because everybody serves the county board and their communities, but their families kind of are along with them because the county board members miss their times with their families and the baseball games and things like that. So we want to thank them at the same time. And usually county board members do a lot of things for their community and the people in their communities to try to improve them. And we'll talk a little bit about John Jay's today. I'll read the resolution and then let Senator Rose present his document. A resolution in honoring retired county board member John Jay, whereas John Jay was sworn in as a Champaign County Board member on December 2nd, 2002, and whereas John Jay has served the citizens of Champaign County as a representative of Champaign County Board District 1 from December 2nd, 2002 until February 23rd, 2017, and whereas during the tenure as a Champaign County Board member, John Jay served on the following standing committees: County Facilities from 2002 to 2012, Highway and Transportation from 2002 to 2017, Labor Committee in 2012, Litigation Committee from 2014 and 2017, and the Committee of the Whole from 2012 to 2017. Whereas during his tenure as a Champaign County Board member, John Jay also served as an alternative liaison, the County Board representative to the Regional Planning Commission Board from 2012 to 2014. And whereas during his tenure as a Champaign County Board member, John Jay also served in a leadership role as the Vice Chair of the Highway and Transportation Committee from 2004 to 2006, 2010 and 2012, and 2016 and 2017, as well as the Vice Chair of the County Facilities Committee from 2011 to 2012. Whereas in the Champaign County Board seeks to publicly recognize the commitment and dedication of John Jay, who served as citizens of Champaign County as elected official over a term of 15 years. Now, therefore, is be it resolved that the Champaign County Board hereby recognizes the service of John Jay and the benefit that service brought to the county government. Be it further resolved that a copy of the resolution be presented to John Jay in recognition of his years' service to the citizens of Champaign County. Presented, adopted, approved, and recorded this 20th day of April, A.D. 2017, Pius Weibel, Gordy Holton, County Clerk. And we actually have Sonny Jay here tonight.
Could we have a second on that motion, please?
Sorry, thank you.
Second by Mr. Mitchell. Discussion? All in favor? All opposed, motion carries.
Thank you. And come forward, and then we'll have Senator Rose come forward.
First of all, Chapin Rose, for the record.
You have to hold the microphone up closer to you.
Right.
You can lift it up by the base. By the base.
There we go. Thank you. Chapin Rose, for the record. I appreciate the departure to allow this. I've been trying to think what I want to say here for a while, but let's start with the official Senate recognition. The State of Illinois 100th General Assembly recognizes my friend John Jay in recognition of 14 years of dedication and service to the Champaign County Board and the citizens it serves. But frankly, he's spent a lifetime serving the citizens of Champaign County. So maybe only 14 years in this role, but he's done a lot for all of us. We call for the commemoration of a successful career and extend our wishes for happiness and continued success in future endeavors. Signed, President John J. Cullerton, Senate President. Ms. Sunny, a lot of things. One of the first people I met when I ran was John, who was at the fire station at the time. And there's nobody prouder, I think, to be a farmer in Champaign County. This is a lot. There's a lot of good farmers here tonight. But John loved agriculture. He loved Muhammad. He loved Champaign County. But most of all, he loved his family. And the last couple times when I talked to John, and by the way, something about John Jay too, the great thing was you always knew where you stood. And there were once or twice where I definitely knew where I stood. But John always called like he saw it and said what was on his heart. And he loves his family. And a lot of my conversations always started with and ended with, what's Miss Sunny think of that? So we're glad you're here tonight. And in the last couple weeks, I've actually enjoyed talking to him about who was going to, can't fill his shoes, but join the county board and enormously proud to be approved.
I want to tell you how much John loved this. He loved the challenge of it and the challenge of each of you. And Brooks, thank you so much for taking his space. You got to have to eat a little bit more to fill his space. But thank you. And thank you.
At any size, I'll always be in John's shadow.
Well, he's a good guy. So keep him in your prayers. And thank you for the time and energies that you have given him and that you allowed him to give you. Thank you.
I have one more communication.
Go ahead.
This is from Fire Chief John Collier from Corn Belt Fire Protection District. 1981, John Jay became the Corn Belt Fire Protection District 6 Fire Chief. In 1998, became the department's first full-time fire chief. For 30 years as fire chief, he gave to the citizens of his community and the members of his department little fanfare acknowledgement. That is not because it was not there for him, but it was the way Chief Jay wanted it. Chief Jay epitomized what it means to be a true public servant, missing any meals, birthday parties, and other family events to ensure those in need were taken care of. He put the needs of our citizens and our firefighters in front of his own each and every day. Thank you will never be enough for the sacrifices he made. He really, when in his discussions, liked working with and serving with the people at the fire station and how they worked to develop the Corn Belt Fire Department. And the chief passed along what would believe to be a fireman's exhortation. And it goes like this. With that, I have a small exhort that I feel puts all of this into a few brief sentences. No, I haven't forgotten the excitement of riding on a fire rig, lights flashing, sirens wailing, nor the feeling of a good save, whether it is a human life or a valued possession of a fellow citizen. I haven't forgotten the feeling of standing ankle deep in freezing water on a 5 below January night, gloves frozen to the nozzle, fighting a fire I know was caused by carelessness or worse. I haven't forgotten the terror of being lost in a smoke-filled building, feeling the taste of hot coffee and cold meat loaf sandwich at 4 in the morning. Now I walk into my old firehouse only to find it filled with strangers. I may not walk as fast or stand as straight as you. My hair may not be gray or thin. My jokes don't come as easy as they once did. But I know in my heart I have paid the price. I have earned the right to say proudly, I'm a retired firefighter. Sincerely, John Collier, Fire Chief, Corn Belt Fire Protection District.
Okay, next we have a ceremony honoring the late Lloyd Carter. First, I'm going to read a letter that Mr. Schneider and I wrote for the family, and then Lorraine will have you read the resolution, okay? to the family of Lloyd Carter Jr. On behalf of the Champaign County Board and the County Administrative Staff, we wish to express our sorrow over the passing of Lloyd, who served faithfully on the board for 24 years. There's no question in our minds that Lloyd was a man of principles from which he never deviated. His political vision was simple and consistent. How could he improve the quality of life for his core constituency, the African-American community of Champaign-Urbana? Lloyd was dedicated to serving the citizens of his district, and he did so throughout his tenure at the county board. On November 17, 2016, the county board unanimously passed resolution number 9778, honoring his many years of serving on the board. A copy of this resolution is attached, and Lorraine, you'll read that now, please.
Resolution number 9778, honoring retiring County Board member Lloyd Carter, Jr. Whereas Lloyd Carter was sworn in as Champaign County Board member on December 7, 1992, whereas Lloyd Carter served the citizens of Champaign County as a representative of Champaign County Board District 5 from December 7th, 1992 until November 30, 2012, and District 11 from December 1st, 2012 until November 30th, 2016. And whereas during his tenure as Champaign County Board member, Lloyd Carter served on the following standing committees: Justice and Public Service from 1992 through 2002, the Environment and Land Use from 1992 to 2002, Highway and Transportation 1992 to 2016, Justice and Social Service from 2002 through 2010, Committee of the Whole from 2010 through 2016, and the Veteran Assistant Commission Committee in 2012. And whereas during his tenure as Champaign County Board member, Lloyd Carter also served in a liaison position as the County Board Representative on the Regional Planning Commission from 1996 through 2004, the Martin Luther King Committee from 2006 through 2010, the Veterans Assistant Committee 2014 to 2016. Whereas during his tenure as Champaign County Board member, Lloyd Carter also served in a leadership role as the Vice Chair of the Justice and Public Safety Committee from 2000 to 2002, Vice Chair of the Highway and Transportation Committee from 2008 to 2016, and Vice Chair of the Veterans Assistance Commission Committee in 2012. Whereas the Champaign County Board seeks to publicly recognize the commitment and dedication of Lloyd Carter, who served the citizens of Champaign as an elected official over a term of 24 years. Now, therefore, it be resolved that the Champaign County Board hereby recognize the service of Lloyd Carter and the benefit that service brought to the county government. And be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be presented to Lloyd Carter in recognition of his service to the citizen of Champaign County. Presented, adopted, approved, and recorded the 17th day of November, AD 2016. Signed by Patsy Petrie, Champaign County Board Chair at that time. So.
Hello. My name is Jenny Baldwin. I work for Congressman Rodney Davis. He could not be here today, but he did send me to give this flag that was flown over the United States Capitol to the family of Mr. Carter in gratitude and in thanks to his service to the Champaign County Board for the past 24 years. I know Mr. Davis was very, very thankful for Mr. Carter and his service, so we have a flag for the family. I can read the letter that the congressman wrote here. Today you are receiving a flag flown over the United States Capitol in recognition of Mr. Lloyd Carter and his many years of service on the Champaign County Board. His decades of leadership and dedication to bettering the community will always be remembered. I have the utmost respect and appreciation for Lloyd and the lasting impact he made on the Champaign-Urbana community and those with whom he served. Please accept this flag on behalf of Mr. Carter. Sincerely, Rodney Davis.
Mr. Rosales will help present the flag. Mr. Rosales. Yeah, I want to thank everybody involved who put this together. I did very little of it, so kudos to all those people who worked hard on getting the flag and having Mr. Davis participate in this and his staff. Again, thank you very much for coming to the meeting tonight. Oh, that's right. We'll now have a 5-minute recess for cake.
Cake break.
That includes... are you serving, Mr. Schneider? Or?
I'm not very good at serving, though. Glad to help.
Mr. Blue, you're welcome to have some cake, too. I know you're hungry. I can tell. Everybody in the audience can have cake, too.
Uh-oh, he just lost a part.
Okay, party's over. However, you can help yourself to seconds at any time if you want to.
Okay, then. I might stop.
Is that yours?
Chocolate
or white? Take it first.
Don't leave my bird. Ain't no money in it, but.
There's part of this baby over here. See ya. Thanks.
Good evening.
Thanks. Bruce.
I'm Lorraine Coward.
Lorraine?
Mm-hmm.
Nice to meet you, Lorraine.
Time to meet.
Yeah, pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's continue with item number 12.
We got to get used to you.
Which is a 5-year financial forecast for general corporate and public safety sales tax funds, which was supposed to be given at the COW meeting, but we ran out of time, so we're giving it here tonight. Mr. Schneider.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We provided an additional copy of the 5-year financial forecast at your desk. I didn't know if everyone would have it brought back tonight. So the document has a considerable amount of detail. So we're just going to do an overview tonight of this. But if you want more reference information, I'd suggest going through this document and looking at some of the items that we're discussing. So there's a lot of things that can affect county finances. We know that at the national level, the rate of inflation, employment rate, income growth. There's also things at the state level like the budget. And then, of course, real estate prices, things that are outside of our control but still impact how we move forward with our budget process. So the good news is that we are expecting inflation to stay fairly low. It's currently projected by the Federal Open Market Committee to remain at around 2% over the next several years. It edged up slightly this year. It had been below 1% for a couple of years, but it's returning to a more normal and moderate rate of inflation. That's also coinciding with expansion economically across the country. For our purposes, the Illinois Department of Revenue indicated that for our PTEL calculation this year, the CPI will be 2.1%. So that's going to allow for some growth in our tax levy, which we'll talk about in a minute. Other environmental factors. State of Illinois. Tammy and I attended a session with Rick Mattoon, who's one of the senior advisors for the Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago back in January. He talked about some of the challenges Illinois faces. Right now, the state is lagging the rest of the Midwest in terms of job growth. In fact, it's only about 20% of what our neighbors to the east and west are seeing. This, of course, is about almost 2 years now that we have not had a full-year state budget approved. We also are seeing at the state level accounts payable exceeding $10 billion. And then we start looking at legacy liabilities, including all of our pension costs. We're estimating at about $174 billion. These are going to weigh on the ability of the state to work with us. And, of course, many of our state share revenues, I think, are going to be influenced by this moving forward. And, of course, you're well aware of some of the other issues we've seen at the county level because of the state's problems. First of all, we've seen delayed or very late reimbursements for grant-funded programs like the Child Support Enforcement Program. I think we recently caught up on part of that, didn't we, Tammy?
Correct.
Yeah. And then also we still are seeing delays in Medicaid application processing that are affecting the nursing home. We also made some key assumptions in putting together the financial forecast. First of all, we know that from our facilities plan last year that we adopted, there's over $22 million in deferred maintenance projects sitting out there. We're going to assume that going forward, we're going to need to issue debt in order to take care of at least a portion of that. I don't believe that we'll have sufficient revenues to do the entire program as it stands. But I think we need to handle some of the critical issues, things to protect the building envelope, so that means roof replacements, repairs to masonry. We have some urgent issues such as the demolition of the old portion of the historic nursing home. That we estimated that cost to be about $750,000. The roof replacements, about $4.2 million. We've also talked about the need to relocate the sheriff's office. We had proposed a plan that was less expensive than building a new facility. That was about $3 million. And then, as you know, we have a 40-year-old enterprise resource planning system that runs all the county financials that also requires replacement. That will cost upwards of $1.8 million. Another major factor impacting our budget, and we're making an assumption on, is that the budgeted expense, not the total growth of the health insurance, but just the portion that the county's general fund will sustain, is going to grow at a rate of about 12% a year. If you've been monitoring the market, you know that we've had over the last several years sometimes increases of 40 to 50% in health care. We've been able to negotiate those numbers down, and our early indication is that we are seeing some improvements in the claims made by our employee group, but I still expect that these numbers are going to continue to see upward pressure. We still have a lot of unknowns right now nationally. We don't know what's going to happen with ACA repeal and replace, or if it's going to stay in place, or whatever Congress may come up with health care going forward. So it's still a big unknown, but if we make an assumption, it's probably going to go up at least that much per year over the next several years. Jump in if you have anything you want to add, Tammy.
I will add something to that. The past few years, we have been able to shift some levy growth from IMRF and Social Security lines. We may be able to do that again in fiscal year 2018. Since we put these numbers together, we did get our IMRF rates, and our regular rate is reduced. Our SLEP rate is status quo. However, our ECHO rate doubled. So we'll be looking at that. There could potentially be a little bit more growth for the general fund if we are able to shift some of the levy growth from IMRF and Social Security lines. This 2.6% does not assume that.
As far as other state shared revenues, we have a lot of concerns about income tax. As I previously mentioned, job growth has been flat or very slowly growing across the state. Because the per capita calculations take into account employment and money across the state, even though we may have a more robust economy locally, we're still affected by the areas that aren't doing as well. So we've seen some fairly large declines in the recent reports. So we're thinking that flat is probably a more reasonable expectation going forward. Maybe some decline, but I think we can go with flat as far as our levels go. Sales tax also has some slow growth expected. That also has flattened out somewhat, not entirely flat, but it's much less than it had been in the prior years. The 1 cent is forecast to grow at about 1.2%, and then the quarter cent tax is forecast to grow at 1%.
One thing I want to mention about the 1 cent tax is that the county's top 10 taxpayers in the unincorporated area make up 50% of those revenues. So the loss of even one of those businesses could have a significant impact on that revenue stream. I mentioned this last month, but the Illinois Department of Revenue has new accounting software that was implemented in March of 2016. So we've seen a lot of volatility in especially income tax and personal property replacement tax. The department has not given very clear direction on that whatsoever. However, I will tell you that as of today, the Illinois Municipal League adjusted down their projections for income tax again. So we think maybe for 2017, our income tax revenues may be slightly overstated. And as Rick mentioned, moving forward, we think it's safe to assume that there won't be additional growth in that revenue line.
Yeah, the thing of concern is Tammy pointed out that, the sales tax is related to businesses, those 10 businesses. They also tend to be located in areas near urban areas. So the problem, of course, then becomes as some of our cities grow and expand, that they absorb some of those businesses. They fall into the incorporated areas, and, of course, we lose that revenue once that happens. So here's a chart that shows you a composition of all of the state share revenues together to give you kind of a relative feel for where we see those going. As you can see, there was a better performance earlier part of the decade as the economy recovered from the recession. But going forward, and year 17, this year, and then next year, not so much. Some other things that we've been seeing with the budget, we're assuming that criminal justice and bond forfeiture revenues are likely to continue to decline. The fact is that changes in policing strategy and also criminal justice reform are impacting the number of cases and the number of fees and fines that are levied. So we are anticipating that to continue to drop for FY17 and further out. Given the current conditions of the nursing home, we don't expect to receive the debt service payments, either the one that was missed for last year or the one that is due later in 2017. We're also assuming that the state will not impose any new unfunded mandates or revenue restrictions. One of the concerns, of course, there's been discussion in dealing with the budget impasse is that a property tax freeze has been floated in Springfield. I don't think that that's going to happen in this session, but I think it's likely that it will happen or be considered seriously at some point. If that happens, that's going to put further constraints on our ability to meet expenditure demands. And, of course, also floating out there is the Carl and Presence Hospital property tax case. I don't know what that final adjudication was going to look like. Hopefully it'll be favorable for us, but if it's not, it's a potential liability for us. I think it's about $808,000 for general fund.
General fund?
Yeah. Anything else you want to add? Okay. All right. So here we have our five-year projection for the general corporate fund. The blue line indicates the revenues, and the red line indicates expenditures. Up to 2017, you can see that we do have a deficit this year, but it's not expanding. But after this year, it does start to, the gap does start to widen. So what that means is that we're going to continue to have expenditures growing at a much faster rate than our revenues, which means we have a structural budget deficit. This is going to be obviously a very challenging time for us going forward in figuring out how we can meet the needs of the county. This chart here gives you the actual numbers that are represented on that earlier chart. You can see without changes, and this is keeping our expenditures as level as we can, and in consideration of our current collective bargaining agreements that are in place or currently being negotiated, and also controls on commodities and services expenditures, we see a widening gap here. By the end of this year, we're anticipating a deficit of about $400,000 between revenues and expenditures. And as you can see, further out it goes, it just gets worse. I really think that the health insurance is probably the major driver of this problem. As we go further out, the 12% growth in budget expenditure just compounds, so it gets worse and worse. Tammy, you want to talk about this here?
If you remember when we initially put together the budget for fiscal year 2017, there was a revenue to expenditure deficit of $150,000 that was associated with capital improvements for ADA projects that the county is required to make under the settlement agreement. Then we revised the budget to include additional potential property tax revenue in case of a favorable ruling in the Supreme Court case associated with the hospital properties. That case has been sent back to the circuit court, so we now know we will not be receiving those revenues. In fact, next month we will likely bring a budget amendment to you to remove those revenues from the budget. So the initial projection revenue to expenditure deficit of $150,000 has now been increased due to mostly due to the inability of the nursing home to be able to reimburse the county, which Rick mentioned earlier. Another impact that we will see in fiscal year 2017 is associated with the foreclosure mediation program. That's going to be about $52,000 that we will see moved out of the general fund balance because of the administrative requirements for that program. The auditor's office and the circuit court have requested that that be made its own fund. So as you see this projected fund balance of a little over $4 million, that also includes the moving out of $52,000 for the foreclosure mediation funds. And the fund balance percentage, as you can see, falls below the requirements of the county's financial policies of 11.3%. One thing I will mention is that if the nursing home does have the ability to reimburse the county for the general obligation debt service, in addition to the ability to pay the county for the services that are provided by the general fund, such as IT services, audit services, and reimburse the county for the outside audit that's attributed to the nursing home, then this number will increase to 12.4%.
Yeah, the debt service is roughly about $282,000 a year. So if you add those together, plus potential lift from reimbursements of some of the other expenses that haven't been taken care of by the nursing home, so you're looking over about $600,000 improvement on the fund balance. So we'd be pretty close, if that happens, we'd be pretty close to our 12.5% requirement for 17. We're still going to have challenges, though, going further out. The other fund we're going to talk about briefly tonight is public safety sales tax. As I talked about earlier with sales tax performance in general, it's been slowing over the last couple of years. Between 2010 and 2014, we had about 2% average annual growth. That's decreased considerably in the last couple of years, where it's either been flat or declining slightly. So the next slide, I think, has, maybe it's further down. The The reasons for this are, I don't know, I think that in general the economy has been still struggling. It just haven't grown as quickly as some other states. We've done better locally. There are some more optimistic projections that some of the other local entities are predicting, but we just, because we're, our money is collected countywide, I think we're going to be a little bit more conservative with our numbers. What does public safety sales tax go towards? There are five alternate revenue bonds that are associated with the tax. A couple of them are staggered so that as one is retired, another one picks up, because some of those bonds initially were set up with interest-only repayment plans. So once one bond gets retired, then some of the debt service gets moved to that other bond and so on. So those will finally be retired by the end of FY 2028. We have one bond that's retiring at the end of this year. That's the Series 2000 bond. That's going to generate an additional $1.2 million beginning next year. That could be money that is applied to some projects that we've been considering, including facilities. We also have some limitations on what we can use that revenue for, so we'll have to be careful with that. The other thing that is mentioned there as a caution is that although we have $1.2 million available beginning next year, the actual debt service payments will start to increase slightly. So we figured that conservatively it's more like about $1 million a year that's going to be available for bonding or doing other projects. So here you can see a chart of the revenue and expenditures for public safety sales tax. Obviously, beginning next year, we see a sharp drop. That's where that $1.2 million is reflected. As I mentioned, we have certain restrictions on what public safety sales tax monies can be used for. In general, we're looking at public safety-related programs, public safety buildings that would be eligible for reimbursement with the additional funds. So it provides some relief for general fund, potentially, I think around $400,000 beginning next year. Reentry programs also funded out of this. So here's a couple of the potential eligible projects from the public safety sales tax money. We've talked about, you know, renovating space in the old annex portion of the nursing home, the old nursing home, possibly for relocation of the sheriff's office. We know that we're going to have some roof replacements coming. The courthouse roof replacement across both buildings is going to run around $1.5 million. The adult detention center requires roof replacement. It's at the end of its service life. We also believe that portion of this money be eligible to fund the ERP replacement. I think it's going to be about, 50.2% on this that we calculated? And that's based on the amount of public safety activities and their portion of the general fund budget. So in talking with the state's attorney's office, we found that that would be appropriate way to allocate what can be spent for public safety services out of that money. I think that's it. So we're ready to answer any questions you may have.
Questions, comments, Ms. Petrie.
Thank you. I have several. First one is, as you were doing your projections, did you put into any consideration what might happen on the federal level in relationship to Medicaid payments and any changes in the amount of money that will come to the state related to Medicaid? They're talking about maybe doing block grants. The second is the talk on the state's level of freezing property tax. And I've forgotten the third, so just answer those and the third will come back to me.
Well, we did take into account possibility of a property tax freeze. It's hard to say. Reading the tea leaves coming out of Springfield, I'm not sure what's going to happen. But I think I don't sense that the General Assembly is going to go in that direction this year based on what I've read. I mean, anything could happen, obviously, before June 30th. But I don't think that we're going to see this affecting us for 2018. But, of course, the next session could be totally different. Who knows if we'll get a budget or not. So it's really hard to say how that happens. What I can say is that most of the growth in the levy that we're predicting for the next few years relies heavily upon property tax revenues improving. So it's going to be have a devastating impact upon counties' ability to fund services if that happens. Now, the other question you had was, on the Medicaid. We really focused on general fund and public safety sales tax at this point. So nursing home obviously is an enterprise fund. Ultimately, if there are problems with Medicaid, those will cascade onto the general fund at some point. So hopefully we will be able to find a resolution to the nursing home challenges in the short term.
I remembered my third question, ERP triggered it. In the past, when we've talked about replacement of IT throughout the whole county system, which is rather expensive, the amount that I remember us talking about. Okay, the amount I remember us talking about was more in the range of $5 million. So you've put up 1.2. Are we still considering that differential, which would be roughly $3.8 million sometime down the line?
The initial costs are going to be in the range of $1.2 to $1.8 million. That's for our basic financials, our payroll, those types of activities. I think that the number you're referring to, if I remember correctly, includes the tax cycle group software as well. So that's another cost that's going to be coming down the line. And again, it's probably going to have to be financed. I don't see us taking it just out of regular revenues.
Other questions or comments from the board? I have one. On the health insurance estimates, I'm wondering if perhaps you said you think at least that maybe you're actually being a little bit liberal, i.e. you're estimating them a little bit high, maybe as worst case scenario, because I know last year we had, 11% increase. The year before that was like 3%. The year before that was like 5 or 6, and obviously it's up and down. So all of a sudden you're bumping it up to double digits where we haven't had much double digits previously. So, and obviously trying to predict health insurance is very difficult, but I'm wondering perhaps if you're overestimating the cost, which is not bad considering what else we have to deal with. Any thoughts about that?
Well, I can tell you the last couple of years in analyzing our claims performance and experience, the claims and actual paid claims have exceeded the premiums by several million dollars. I don't remember the exact dollar figure, but it was substantial. And that's why last year we had the initial proposal of a 51% increase in the premium. This year, we've seen, at least initially, we believe there will be a return to more normal levels of claims, although we know that there are a number of high claim cases out there. Last year, we had 10 claim cases that exceeded $125,000 each. So that total there is likely to remain in our experience. And so when insurance companies look at us for business, it's going to impact our numbers for at least the next couple of years because they're going to take that into account. Even though we've had a more recent drop for this year, which will benefit us, they do factor in the performance of those other previous years. It's usually 2 or 3 years back that they go when they start computing premiums, which I think is going to continue to impact us going forward.
Now, I assume when you say these expensive cases, you accept like, say, a hip replacement surgery or something like that, or some serious cancer.
Most of these cases, I believe, are cancer-related.
Okay.
And, in fact, one of the statistics we saw, Tammy, you correct me if I'm wrong, but I know that many of those cases also appeared in our pharmaceuticals. I believe the highest pharmaceutical users in the county, I think they accounted for, 80% of the cost? Just on those 10 people. So those particular health disorders are very expensive to treat. It's kind of interesting. You have a cluster of people who are unfortunately very ill. We also have 40% of county employees who don't use the services at all of our insurance. So it's the whole model is, of course, that everyone puts
right.
in a little, and hopefully that that together will pay for all the expenses.
Okay, thank you. Mr. McGuire.
obviously we can see these documents well, and you've done a great job explaining all of them, but the numbers that I look at for the audience, hopefully we have an audience more than two or three people. We've done a pretty decent job of trying to keep a decent fund balance, and we look at 2017 and that fund balance is $4 million. But when you look out, I mean, obviously, Chairman's right, it can be a little bit off. But when we look at a fund balance in 2021 and it's negative $3.5 million, and we have unbelievable numbers of responsibilities to take care of that we don't really even have in a budget anywhere to manage. You know, we talk about taking care of ERP or the downtown jail or whatever else that might happen. That's a significant problem because that's going to cut into a regular general fund budget, whether it's a police on the street, buildings, roads, circuit clerk, all those things. That's a chunk of our regular budget. That's a significant problem.
One of the challenges, too, I mean, we've tried to find different ways to be creative. I think the county's done a good job of cost containment. Department heads have been, I think, about trying to keep their requests in line with what the need. Last year, as I began my role with the county, I noticed that there were a significant number of budget amendments, and the budget amendments that were coming before the board here were for things that were truly needed. There were contracts and other some unanticipated expenses that happened. So they weren't frivolous requests. So it tells me that in the previous year we had a 4% cut at commodities and services asked of the department. So I think we've squeezed all the blood from the turnip we can on that area. If you look at the general fund budget, about 70% of it is personnel costs. It's wages and fringes. And I don't think that reflects the county that has overpaid its employees by any means. In preparing for collective bargaining negotiations with Fraternal Order of Police and with AFSCME, we do studies of comparable counties and comparable entities in terms of wages. And I can tell you that our employees aren't overpaid. Just doing some and looking at some unaudited numbers from the local market. Of course, we're not a city. We don't have the ability to raise revenue like a city does. A home rule entity obviously has much more power to do revenue enhancement. But if you look at City of Champaign, their typical average cost for an employee is right around $108,000, I believe. The city of Urbana is around $90,000. The county spends about $72,000 when you count all wages and fringes and average amount among our employee groups. So, you know, I know that there may be some feelings that certain groups are getting ahead of the market, but overall, the county is not overcompensating its employees by any means. But the fact is that it is the major source of our costs, and that that's probably the only place where we're going to have any ability to ameliorate this projected budget deficit, unless we have some other ways to raise revenue.
Wire?
In plainer English, you're talking about cutting jobs and positions at the county, right? I mean, because that's the only place where there's really any money is in salaries.
I think if we depart from a practice where we keep our recurring expenses in line with recurring revenues, we're going to trouble spot with financial our finances. So, much. I think there are some other recommendations we'll be making for May as we go forward for the budget planning process. The last option for us would be to ask for layoffs, but I think there's a number of creative things we can do. First of all, one thing we may recommend is that the county engage in a study of exactly which services are statutorily required versus those that are not. I think that in a situation like this, we ought to look very hard at any expenditures that are not required by law and continue those before we have to cut into services that are required. Another thing that might be a short-term strategy would be to engage in some furloughs rather than layoffs. We must have to cut service hours in some places. Who knows, maybe the possibility of a four-day work week for some operations where it is feasible could also save the county money, not only in wages, but also with utility costs. Employees would save on transportation costs. So.
Anything else? Okay, thank you very much. Rick, why don't you swap out that microphone with somebody else because the next person will need it. All right, the next item will be county facilities. There's no action from the county facilities. You can, there's a summary of the action on page 74. ELUC, we have one item from ELUC. Mr. Esri.
Thank you, Mr. Weibel. I move adoption of ordinance number 990, amending zoning ordinance for a zoning map amendment on certain property, 830-AM-16, changing the zoning designation from AG2 agriculture to AG1 agriculture on property located at 1766 County Road 1850 North, Urbana. And I also move for a roll call vote to record the 17 affirmative votes required for approval of this zoning map amendment.
Second by Mr. Hartke. Ms. Petrie.
Thank you very much. I need to get to the page where I wrote this. I would make a motion to amend this resolution. If you look at your resolution, the motion is to added to under 2A, a 2B, and I will read it to you, and provide proof 365 days after the resolution approval and annually thereafter to the increase of traffic due to this zoning amendment.
Is there a second? Is there a second?
I'll second that.
We have a second by Mr. Harper.
Yeah, it's hard to believe it's actually 17 feet wide. There's no shoulder and very narrow ditches. And the ZBA put in a criteria under the special use, several. One is that no venue use during planting season and no venue use during harvest season because it's impossible to pass traffic and farm machinery. I'm not sure how the present large farm machinery actually can pass on that narrow road. And so part of that special use permit is that requirement to report the use of that venue for the different occasions. So putting a traffic count requirement as an amendment to this resolution doesn't put any greater onus on the proprietor of the venue. And we do need to start doing some requirement for these venues that are coming, being established throughout the county in relationship to the increase of traffic and the road use. And to remind people, this happens to be located in Summer Township, and that is not the poorest township, but it is a township that is not robust in road funds. So I did ask Mr. Blue to check about that road with that township commissioner and road commissioner, and the road commissioner feels the road presently is in good shape, and what I drove the road, it does appear to do that. I'm not a civil engineer, so it's only a windshield survey of the road. But my concerns are the following: the narrowness of the road, people who are not used to driving in the county in relationship to that road, there are no lights out there, there's no maneuverability since there's no shoulder, and traffic will be heavy throughout there at certain times when the venue is heavily used. It was mentioned that they have planted trees along a fence on the south side of the property. when I was looking at the property, that looked like it was an overflow parking area. That's not my concern. My concern is as those trees grow, and I've mentioned this to John Hall, a line of sight issue when the trees get taller and cars are there and they're ingressing and egressing the property. That doesn't address it. It's just a side concern that I have as I went out and looked at the property. Therefore, that's the reason for my motion for this amendment.
A discussion on the proposed amendment. Ms. Michaels.
I have a question. I think it kind of goes with your amendment and the original. I thought that this was already open to the public and already proceeded as a regular established business.
Mr. Hall can best answer that question. Mr. Hall? I could answer that, but he'd do it better.
Well, it's my understanding that they have been having small events. Not a great number of those either. And it is my understanding that the events they've been having fits within what the zoning ordinance calls a temporary use permit, which is to say no more than five times in any 90-day period. And I don't think they've been exceeding that so far. They have been advertising heavily, I know, but the evidence at the Zoning Board of Appeals was that they really have not violated what they should have been doing so far.
And if I can have a follow-up, what normally is the width of a road if you're going to have an establishment like that?
Well, there is no normal width. 17 feet is certainly not the narrower roads out in the county, but it would be better to have a little wider road, but I want to stress that the ZBA imposed a condition on the special use. If this special use is not approved, there will probably be this much traffic generated anyhow because they've agreed not to sell off the two residential lots that they could sell off. And even if the special use is not approved, they can still do the temporary use. And the ZBA established limits on use that even if the special use is approved, the traffic will not go beyond what it could be otherwise. So the ZBA was very concerned about traffic. And, you know, there have been other event centers, but there's never been an event center agreeing to conditions like this.
Mr. Reyes, remember we're talking about the amendment now, so talk about the traffic.
Yeah, the traffic. The traffic was discussed at ELUC, and in general I made this comment, and we do have Mr. Blue here. He could probably back me up. In this county, if you're off of an asphalted two-lane road, one that has stripes down the middle and is true asphalt, not just tar and chip, you're probably on a road that's already carrying traffic above and beyond, well above and beyond what it's designed for. It's just a fact of life out there. I'm not saying this is interesting. It's not saying that more traffic is better, but it's just the fact of life out there. If you live out in the county and travel the tar and chip roads, and I live on Windsor Road Extended, just briefly past 130, so it gets used. And why wouldn't you? If you lived in Ogden, Sydney, wherever, and you're coming in to, say, the U of I to work, yeah, you'd jump on that road and run right in there. Well, it's a tar and chip road, and it is well above what it was designed for. So that's just a general comment on traffic out in the county.
Mr. Harper, go ahead.
Mr. Fuentes, what's the capacity of an event?
Do we have to talk about the amendment?
Well, I'm trying to get an idea of just how big of, I mean, is this for 200 people?
Okay, proceed. Go ahead, proceed.
100 people, yep. Or is it a 50? Mr. Hall, yes, please.
The special use permit has a limit of 150. That's what the septic system has been designed for, and that's the capacity of the seating area. That's actually a good point. This is the smallest event center that we've had also.
Let's go with Mr. Brooks.
Who are you proposing would administer the traffic count?
Well, it's what I referred to in the fact that it's already in what the ZBA approved, that they do have to report on a regular basis what occasions are being held out there and how many people due to the special use limitations that have been placed on it. So accounting for the number of cars that are out there is not much of an additional onus. Okay. Can I answer something?
Go ahead, Ms. Petrie.
Oh, just to Mr. Esri. Yeah, it is tar and chip. There are no lines anywhere out on that road. Yeah.
Mr. McGuire.
Going to the amendment, I think if we are, someone's going to count the cars if that's part of the amendment. And going back to the budget earlier, Mr. Hall was denied additional staff because we didn't have the budget to give staff. So if he ends up being the one that's out there trying to do it, he already doesn't have the time and the staff to do that. So I wouldn't want to support that. The owners of the property is going to do that? And as he said, this is more about, is somewhat written to limit the size of the use more than increase it. So,
further discussion on the amendment. Okay, Mr. Hall.
Mr. Esri mentioned how many votes are required to approve this. I don't think it was mentioned that 17 are required because there is this frontage protest. State law says if more than 20% of a protest, you know, along the property line is against the map amendment, then it triggers the supermajority requirement. And indeed, that's the situation here. More than 20%, it's about 50% of the bordering property lines have protested the map amendment. And so in order to approve it, it requires 17 votes.
Further discussion, Mr. Goss. We're still talking about the amendment now.
Right. I was just going to say, before we vote on the amendment, could we have it restated again?
Certainly. Please, Ms. Petrie.
Yes, I'll read it to you again. It would become 2B, and provide proof 365 days after the resolution approved and annually thereafter to the increase of traffic due to this zoning amendment. And just to clarify for Mr. McGuire, what the ZBA put in their special use permit, it's self-reporting. It has nothing to do with Mr. Hall or his staff being out there. And this is in response that we have been approving venues out in the country, and only one did a traffic count, and that is Pear Tree. And it's on the Dewey Fisher Road, and then that road got improved and expanded. But the other two that have been approved, there has been no ask for what it's going to do to increasing traffic. And to counter Mr. Hall's argument, it's a rule of thumb with road engineers that one house generates 20 car travels per day. So, no, 10, sorry, John. And so that's how he got to the 20. Well, 20 is still much less if they do have a robust occasion out there. And so this is just to respond to some of the concerns that the people who brought the protest forward, and that is the reason behind this.
Mr. Rosales.
Yeah, I cannot support this amendment because we're forcing this particular business, which is the smallest of those businesses that we have out in the county, to stipulate something that is not required of the other businesses. So how could we go ahead and implement such a policy when we don't cannot implement it across the board? If we do one, we have to do all. And if we haven't done all, and then we should not do this one. So I would be against amending what was already passed by the ZBA.
Further discussion? Ms. Petrie?
Then, Mr. Rosales, do we take it to the logical conclusion that what the ZBA passed for this one, you wouldn't approve at all because what they did for this one has all kinds of special uses in it which were not applied to any of the other three?
I would address that to Mr. Hall because I think they're the experts. They're the ones that I take their advice. And if they were approved at 6-0, I'm not the expert. I don't do road counting. I don't know what actual chip and oil is. So I cannot, off the top of my head, answer your question, Ms. Petrie. I would leave it to our advisory board, which is the zoning board.
Further discussion on the amendment? Okay. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? It does not pass. We're back to the main amendment as originally stated. Further discussion on that. Mr. Esri, go ahead.
I will just make a few comments, I guess, from some of the notes that John Hall has for me. The ZBA, with one member absent, voted 5-1 to recommend an enactment. The ZBA was aware of the protest. And most of the neighbors provided testimony at the public hearings or hearing. The ELEC committee recommended approval unanimously. There was discussion about it going on the consent, but we got to talk about it, and well, consent's only passed with a simple majority, and this needed 17, so that's why it didn't go on consent. ZBA voted 6-0 to approve the special use permit in related zoning case 831-S-16, and that special use permit will not be valid unless the map amendment is approved by us, the county board. There's several, he's got a list here of the different special conditions, but I believe a lot of those were in the memo if you read it in the email. So those are just a few other things I thought I'd mention.
Thank you, Mr. Esri. Further comments? Mr. Hall, I have a question. How is one defined planting and harvest season? Is it done statewide or is it done by locally? Or
Dates are specified. Basically, I think it's April 15th to May 31 as planting and a similar month and a half period is for part of it.
Have an event? Okay. All right. Thank you. Further discussion? Okay. Let's have a roll call vote.
King?
Yes.
Marsh?
Yes.
McGuire?
Yes.
Michaels?
Yes.
Mitchell? Patterson? Petrie?
No.
Rosales?
Yes.
Summers?
Yes.
Tinsley?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Clemens?
Yes.
Cowart?
Yes.
Cruz?
Yes.
Esri?
Yes.
Gus?
Yes.
Harper?
Yes.
Hartke?
Yes.
Heiser?
Yes.
Weibel?
Yes. I believe the motion passed. Is that correct? We got 17? I think we had 18.
18.
Okay. The motion does pass 18 votes. Thank you, Mr. Esri.
Could Mitchell be the woman that voted?
He did. So.
Is that allowed?
Yes, you can. Okay. Highway and transportation, we're going to deal with that later because that meeting was canceled. So let's go down to finance. Mr. Ellis did not show up. Ms. Michaels, are you ready to take over finance for us?
Sure. There you go. I have adoption of resolution number 9926, authorizing payment of claims.
Second by Mr. Esrae. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Secondly, I have adoption of resolution number 9927, authorizing purchases not following purchasing policy.
Second by Mr. Hartke. Discussion?
I have a note.
Go
Mr.
ahead,
Farmy.
Go ahead, Ms.
Talking to Mr. Farney earlier, once again, we have a lot of things that are being cleaned up from the nursing home that were prior to this year, so that's why there's a big, long list.
Thank you. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. And why don't you continue down on the new business, the item under finance?
Yes, sir. Adoption resolution number 9953, authorizing budget amendment 17-00006. From Fund Department 080, which is the General Corp, to 075 General County, increased appropriations of $4,340 and revenue of $14,858 of funds that we have received from the special assessment in the St. Joe Thomas Paine Drainage District Number 3, and increased appropriations for our feasibility study for a Champaign County Land Bank, approved by ELUC on 4-6-2017.
Second by Mr. Esrae. Discussion, Mr. Esrae.
Well, I guess I was just going to note that we do have Mr. Hall here still. If there's questions on, and Rick too, on the idea of the land bank.
I did provide a memo in your briefing packets on this just to talk about this very shortly. This idea originated with the village of Rantoul. They approached the cities of Champaign and Urbana as well as Champaign County about the concept of looking into a land bank for our area. What a land bank would do is would promote economic development by providing an alternative method of marketing and disposing of distressed properties. Rantoul in particular has a number of residential properties that have been difficult to sell for redevelopment, but all of us have some properties, even Champaign County, as you've noted, we've had a number of properties come before County Board in the past, requiring a significant amount of effort by the State's Attorney's Office and others in the county staff to dispose of. The land bank would be responsible for doing this. What we're proposing is that help fund a feasibility study to see how this would be structured, how it would be funded, and how it would actually be implemented in terms of the charter, what it would do, what it would not do. I see a number of potential goods coming out of this besides getting rid of properties. I think it's a public good to promote infill development within our urban areas. I think Ms. Petrie has talked about this before, and that I think in the city of Champaign, there's enough property to support development for the next 20 years without expanding the sprawl area around the cities. So it's also a way, I think, to help conserve farmland. We have a lot of wonderful, highly productive farmland in the county, and rather than building on greenfield developments where we're putting up large areas or buildings that require huge infrastructure investments that we don't have, we should be able to use or build on property that is within the city areas and utilize the infrastructure that's there.
If I can say something, it is the city of Champaign, city of Urbana, the village of Rantoul, and the county. So there are all four parts participating together and collaborating, each with 25% of the fee for this study.
Thank you.
Will this thing also include the so-called brownfields on the former Air Force Base in Rantoul?
I think that's something that would be handled with the feasibility study, yes.
Okay. Further discussion? Mr. King.
Yes. My question, I think, essentially have the three or four, ways that it promotes economic growth through acquisition, assembly and disposal of public property, or including tax-reverted properties. Is there within that group, is there a particular group that is most, acquired through land banking, would you say, or?
I'm not really an expert on land banks. I couldn't say for sure.
Okay. I think my concern was just that maybe some of the properties, if they were to go, if there was a sort of an outside group that was operating by us that would grab all of these properties, does that limit, say, a private investor or someone within the community that wanted to approach these properties, or how does that work?
Well, I don't think so. I think that the point of doing something like this is the properties have been neglected by the market, so they've been difficult to deal with through normal means. So the land bank is there to help encourage and, promote those properties to the wider audience and also find people who would be willing to invest. I think that, I'm not sure, but I thought Vermilion County also had done something along these lines, and it's been successful for them.
Further questions? Mr. Marsh, I got it right this time.
You can call me Brooks. It's fine. Everyone does. I have a real concern about this. These, in some areas, have become money holes where the counties and cities take over the worst of the properties, have to rehab them, and sell them at tremendous losses rather than let the market take care of these properties. And so I have a concern. I think with everything we have on our plate, this is a big thing to take on, and I'm very concerned that we would do that at this time.
Point out, this is just a feasibility study.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay.
I'm concerned about that as well. I don't think we need to go any further.
Ms. Petrie, did you have a comment?
Well, just a comment to Mr. Marsh, and I had sort of expressed not quite your concern, but a concern in that land banks can be misused. And I was hoping as they worked through the feasibility study that they also looked at criteria on how the land bank properties could be used or dedicated, or along with a comprehensive plan or the goals of the county or wherever these properties are located, so it doesn't become a detriment, but it becomes a win-win.
Thank you, Ms. Petrie. Further comments or questions? Okay, see none. We need a roll call vote with 15 votes to pass.
King?
No.
Marsh?
No.
McGuire?
Yes.
Michaels?
Yes.
Mitchell?
No.
Patterson?
Yes.
Petrie?
Yes.
Rosales?
Yes.
Summers?
Yes.
Tinsley?
No.
Anderson?
Yes.
Clemens?
Yes.
Cowart? Yes. Cruz?
Yes.
Esri?
Yes.
Das?
No.
Harper?
Yes.
Hartke?
No.
Heiser?
Yes.
Weibel?
Yes, I count 14. Okay, motion fails. Okay, next up is Highway and Transportation. First, I'd like to motion to defer the rules since this did not go through committee. Should somebody move that, please? Moved by Mr. Mitchell. Is there a second? Second, Mr. Harper. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Ms. Cowart.
Okay, the Highway and Transportation did not have a meeting this month, so we've got Mr. Blue here that can answer any questions concerning the five items that's on the agenda. The first one is adoption of Resolution 9921, awarding contract for replacement of bridge located on Monticello Road, section 16-00039-00BR, and I so move.
Is there a second? Second by Mr. Esri. Discussion. We have Mr. Blue here dressed in a blue outfit. seeing no discussion, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Next is adoption of resolution number 9922, awarding contract for the reconstruction of Sierra 20, County Road 23, Dewey Elliott Road section 14-00438-00RS, and authorizing the county board chair to sign the truck route access program agreement. I so move.
Second by Ms. Michaels. Discussion. I'm going to ask Mr. Blue, is this the entire Dewey Elliott Road, more or less?
It's our portion from U.S. 136 up to the county line.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Mr. McGuire.
Yeah, we should make them work a little bit, although we do have them up late. I see that the proposal thought it would be 22.960, and we came in at two bids at 2994 and 3123, which are, of course, higher. Are we expecting increased costs of construction overall in all these bids, or just that one?
Well, the low bid at 2994 is $33,000, which is about 1% over the engineer's estimate. And on a project of this size and magnitude, to be within 1%, regardless of whether you're higher or lower, I think shows us that the price basically came in where we thought it was going to be. I mean, I would have liked for it to be $33,000 under, but it came in $33,000 over. But the asphalt was up a little bit from where we thought it was going to be. The remainder of the stuff was pretty similar. So that was the one thing that I saw that was a little higher than we had anticipated.
Further questions? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Next one is adoption of resolution number 9923, authorizing application for public transportation financial assistance under section 5311 of the Federal Transit Act of 1991, as amended, 49 USC 5311, and I so move.
Second by Mr. Mitchell. Discussion. Mr. Blue, you have anything to say about this?
This is not my agenda item. The next three are actually coming from the Regional Planning Commission. So if you have any questions, they are here to answer them. If
any questions for Rita or Zoe on this item? Seeing none? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Next one is adoption of resolution 9924. Authorizing acceptance of the special warrant for.
Anybody want to hear any more about this? Mr. McGuire. Okay, Rita, Zoe, you want to say something about this one? Can you speak a little closer to the mic? Aim your chin at the mic, sort of like this. Try that. I think we're trying to save money by buying cheap batteries.
Thank you.
Okay. Oh, that's definitely better. Okay. Okay, so just a quick rundown of our current operations. This here is our service map. We do cover all of Champaign County as long as the destination or the origin is within the rural part of the county. Just a little bit of our fares generally, and these are all one-way costs. Our cost is, unless you're in the Rantoul area, that yellow, that's a two-way, $2 one-way trip. Everywhere else in the county is $5, with the exception of children under 12 or $1, and adults over 60 or $2. And then our deviated fixed route, which we just started in the village of Rantoul, that's $2 within Rantoul for a one-way trip and $5 on the connecting route to Champaign-Urbana. We do have the dash card through MTD, and if riders pursue that, then they get a discount. Just a little bit about our last year of service. I took the total numbers from the last, or the most recent four quarters that we have service reports for. Our total trips are just over 20,000. Daily average is 80. Our main trip types are employment at 45.4% and medical at 26.8%. Our ADA lift use is 10.4%, and senior trips are 28.2%. Those are following normal trends. Our trip denials are at just a little over 1,000, and trips per mile are down just a little bit at 0.053. Trips per hour are steady at 1.22.
Go ahead, Ms. Petrie.
Thank you. A couple, or maybe these will come up on another slide, and if so, just tell me. But some of the data that I would like to see is the cost that you're charging people, is that covering what percentage of the cost to run the program? That's number one. And you have 80 daily average trips, but there's no range of what is made per day. Are these trips that are on the lower end of the cost factor, or they average out, or they're all going to Champaign at $5 a trip, things of that nature, so we have a better sense of, or a GIS map that shows us a bit of what, where the intensities are. Even though you have an employment and medical, that still doesn't tell me the density of the trips.
Okay. To address the first question about, and let me know if I'm misunderstanding, you're asking about the cost of the fare that we charge in relation to the amount that we're spending on each trip. With rural public transit, because of the distance and trying to keep things affordable for the riders, who are often either seniors or low income, I don't have an exact percentage, and I could get that for you and send it out, but it's very low.
I understand that. I understand the purpose of it, but I was curious how much, in other words, it would help me understand how much subsidizing we're doing for this program.
I'd be happy to look at those figures and get that out to you. And the second question was about the density of the trip types. Okay. The thing is that if the systems that are able to do that have the ITS software that we've mentioned in previous meetings that track things on more of a coordinate basis, what we have is two dispatchers who work with spreadsheets and so at this point, it's very hard to do something like that and time-intensive if we wanted to do that. But thank you for the question.
Let's go to Mr. McGuire, then we'll go to Mr. Goss. Go ahead, Mr. McGuire.
Sorry, thanks. So we should have had you talk to Jenny while she was here about... It's on. It's punished.
Speak a little louder, closer to it, maybe.
Hello, hello, testing.
There you go.
So we should talk to Congressman Davis's office about changing the connection between the federal grant, because the scattergram, the people that are allowed to do the transportation, we had this discussion before, the tracking electronically at MTD aren't allowed to work with local people because of the funding? No? Okay, because of differences in funding is the issue, right? So we have to figure out if we can get that changed. Okay. And the other one is you have trip denials, 1,100. What are those reasons that you would deny a trip? You seem like a nice person. I don't understand.
Luckily, I don't have to deny any of them personally. Our biggest reason is that the time that they request the trip is not available. In other words, all of our drivers that we can have out at one time are out and aren't able, none of the vehicles, which we have about 8 at peak, they're not able to accommodate the trip. And so this is a pretty common thing in rural transit just because of, the spatial factors. We're back and forth to Rantoul, down to the southern parts of the counties, and a lot of the time, people have a very specific time that they need to be at a medical appointment in town. It's just difficult to kind of pack the buses as easily as a fixed route service, like MTD does. ITS would help with that as well. So I don't know if that answered your question. Okay. That's I want to say that's 90% of the reason. A few of them are things like people calling from outside the service area. At this point, we don't travel outside of Champaign County, and some people are trying to travel from a different county into Champaign. And, of course, we have to deny those trips. And a few, a very, very small percentage, are people calling in within the 48-hour reservation time frame, so they miss their cutoff. Occasionally we can accommodate those, but even though they've gone against the policies that we've laid out, we still have to count those as denials.
Mr. Goss. Okay.
And we do every quarter through our Rural Transit Advisory Group, which is a subcommittee of the county board, and Ms. Michaels is our liaison for that. We do provide a quarterly service report that breaks down those denials. So we do keep track of the reasons for that.
Okay, go ahead, continue.
Thank you. Oh, boy. Sorry, our font, we just uploaded new fonts for RPC, and they did not translate very well. I will do a PDF next time. So this is just a general slide about the process for the grant applications. Each spring, we're required to submit an application for continued funding of the program. This year, they have split the federal and state applications into two pieces, and that's due to the Grants Accountability and Transparency Act that's slowly making its way to all of our programs in the county. And essentially, it's the same process, all of the same requirements. It's just kind of how they've divided it up. And then, so this is just a comparison of our FY17 budget and our budget for the fall, for the upcoming fiscal year. You can see that we are looking at a decrease in the budget. I'll talk about the reason for that in the next slide. However, our federal apportionment is the same as last year. Our farebox revenue is estimated to be the same. And our service contract amount has bumped up a little bit. The reason for that is that our RAN tool service contract will be throughout the whole year for this fiscal year, whereas last year, for FY17, it was only a partial year. So last year's budget, if you'll recall, and I know there are a lot of new faces here, but IDOT had given us direction that we should inflate our budget to account for the entire downstate operating assistance appropriation. And so basically how we achieved that is added some extra revenue to a previously empty revenue line and added to the miscellaneous expenses to balance that out. So what we're doing is essentially we're looking at a realistic budget for this year, which is an emphasis of the GATA process. We're requesting $566,385 in the downstate operating assistance, which is two-thirds of the allocated amount. At this point, we would love to draw down all of that money, but it's not realistic at this point. So just to kind of give an idea of previous years, FY13, we spent $318,000 in DOPE. FY14 was just under $350,000. FY15 was just under $400,000. And FY16 was about $412,000. So we're still at about $150,000 more than we've spent, even in the most current fiscal year. So we have accounted for a generous amount of increase there. So we're not worried about having to amend the budget to ask for more of that appropriation.
Ms. Petrie.
Could you go back to your previous slide for a moment, please? So you're comfortable with this huge drop. I mean, that's $200,000, basically.
Yeah. So we inflated our expenses about $200,000 last year. And that was at the direction of IDOT. That was their suggestion in the budget climate that was going on last year.
Well, the budget climate hasn't changed.
Going to go back and look at our actual expenditures over the last 5 years and say, how can you, justify that?
I just wanted to make sure that everything's being done to protect the program.
Absolutely.
Mr. Anderson.
Thank you. On a previous slide, it was mentioned that you had about 20,000 trips last year. And that was about 16,000 hours. It's about 48 minutes a trip. What is a trip? Is that I make an appointment, if you will. You come to my house, and I travel 12 miles. Is that the trip, or is it the fact that you went to Gifford, and then when that you dropped off at Gifford, now you had to leave Gifford to go to my house? And then take me to my destination. What is the trip?
So you're asking whether we count the time.
16,000 miles represent just when I was in the vehicle?
So you're asking if it includes the time, the hours spent driving basically without a passenger on board?
Right.
Rita, do you know? I can't remember.
Because that calculates also, that factor also comes into the number of miles you had posted, I think close to 300 some thousand.
For the first person that we are picking up, it includes the time that we travel from the office, from where the bus leave, like MTD, and go to the first person. That's one trip. It includes that. But after that will be every time that we collect and pick up another person.
But you're not picking up and dropping off to person to person. You're at MTD, you have to go to Rantoul,
mm-hmm.
and that person wants to come here for a hospital mm-hmm. appointment, And then from here, you have to go to Savoy to pick up somebody, mm-hmm. and then take them over to where somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So in essence, let's just say you traveled 50 miles,
mm-hmm.
but your passengers were only in the vehicle for 20 of those miles.
Mm-hmm.
What does the 27 represent, or the 20,000 miles? All 50 miles or just the... You get what I'm saying. What are we counting here?
We have to count from the point that the bus leave the office at MTD and come back, and that's the total number of miles
for
that,
the day.
That bus did. And that's, and we count a trip every time that a person calls and say, hey, could you please pick me up here? Okay, that's one trip that we are doing to pick you up. And then another trip will be when you... and you are drop off, then if we are doing a return trip, that will be picking you up and taking you home.
So your miles are the miles that that vehicle made all day.
Yes.
Times the number of vehicles on the road today. It all equaled 16,000 miles last year.
Mm-hmm.
And you had 20,000 trips out of that.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Thank you.
Mr. McGuire.
As part of the increased budget last year, we bought some vehicles.
The vehicles actually don't come at any cost to us. We procure them through the state, and that's all federally and state funded.
Okay, you have more?
Okay. The last thing that I have for you is every year we're required to report the reason for any budget line item increase or decrease of 10%. These are pretty quick this year. Our service contract revenue from the Village of Rantoul is up 22%. And as I said earlier, that's because we've got a full year of service, whereas we started in November of this past year. The state operating assistance decreased from decreased 26%, and I explained the reason for that as well. The leases and rentals decreased 25% when C-carts moved to the new operating space in the new MTD maintenance facility, and that will actually further decrease in FY19 because this $33,000 includes furniture that MTD purchased and we are paying off. The miscellaneous expenses are down 96% because that's what we inflated so heavily last year to balance the budget. And that's all I have. If there are any further questions, I'm available.
Questions or comments? Mr. Anderson.
Thank you. If I remember correctly, when the Village of Rantoul entered in this contract last year, they were going to try it for 1 year. And then they were going to decide what to do. Have they now extended that to a second year?
So the original contract was for 2 years.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
Never mind that. My, I've remembered incorrectly. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Rick, go ahead. Do you have a question?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Zoe, can you just speak to what the status is now with the state reimbursements for the program?
Last time we had some problems.
We are all up to date. MTD has been paid for the second quarter. Some good news. Somebody filed a lawsuit.
Hello? Is that working now? Okay. Further questions or comments on this item? Ms. Cord, you want to turn off your microphone? Mr. McGuire, too. Okay, let's have a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Next item.
Adoption of ordinance number 989, providing public transportation in Champaign County.
Is there a second? Second by Ms. Petrie. Actually, Zoe, why do we have this amendment? Or why do we have this resolution? Sorry, microphone. And I notice that also it replaces number 978. Is this an update of some sort?
The ordinance? That's a requirement. When we do grant applications for IDOT, we have to submit all those documents. That's part of the requirement for the grant application.
Any other questions for that? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. I think that's it for Highway. Thank you, Ms. Cowart. Next up, we have a couple items. One on the nursing home, proposal for interim management services discussion. Mr. Schneider.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As you recall, last time we talked about the nursing home, one of the areas of concern I expressed was around the stabilization of the home's finances and management. The current company providing management services, MPA, has a contract that will expire on June 30th. I have been researching some options on potential paths forward. Right now, based on consulting with people who are fairly, I would consider experts in the healthcare field who have examined the home and talked to staff, I think our best path forward right now is to seek an extension with the current nursing home administrator, Karen Nofke. I've indicated that she has very strong support among the staff, and also she has a tremendous wealth of knowledge in nursing home operations. And I think for those reasons, as well as continuity, I think it would make sense to utilize her services going forward. So I've entered into a discussion with her about that. In addition, one of the consultants I had mentioned actually did a site visit this week at the home, spent a day there talking with Karen as well as staff members, department heads, and residents to get a feel for it. I'm going to be drafting a scope of work for a proposal that the consultant will provide to the county fairly shortly. What I've envisioned is that this consultant would take over the responsibilities currently performed by MPA. So business office services, dealing with compliance. As you know, we also have an option to continue compliance services through MPA. They have offered to at least do that. So we have a couple of potential paths with that. I've also talked with some other companies who are interested in working on a short-term engagement with us. So if this this primary opportunity doesn't work, we have some alternatives to pursue also. So I'll report back to County Board as soon as I have something more definite.
Any questions for Mr. Schneider on this item? Ms. Petrie.
Yes, I do. You seem to have several options for kind of strategic management, but do you also have any additional options in case Ms. Nofke chooses not to want to continue on an interim basis?
I've talked with a couple people. I know that through our contacts in the industry, there are other nursing home administrators available to work specifically on short-term engagements like this. So that would be my intent, is to bring someone who's going to be in the home on a daily basis, not someone who's been managing remotely. So I think that's really important. And also, that was a point made with the consultant that came up to visit. We actually discussed him taking residence in the home in one of the empty bedrooms to be there 24 hours, not just a few hours a day or a week.
I have a follow-up question, and this may be too early. You certainly wouldn't have a definitive answer, but it's based on the conversation that we had during caucus, and that is with no longer having a contract with MPA, that releases some funds because we won't be paying them. Would those funds then be basically absorbed with these two transitional entities that you've described to us?
We'd have to determine what the scope of services is to be, and then also what kind of cost is associated with it. I expect that a good percentage of those dollars would be absorbed by a different service. I don't think we're going to necessarily benefit cost-wise from a short-term entity.
Further questions? Are there any objections to the directions that Mr. Schneider is going in? I see none.
Okay.
Go ahead, Ms. Petrie.
Just one last logistic question. To ease of a transition, any transition, is there a willingness to have an overlap of time between MPA and whoever comes in so that there is some communication going on and things of that nature?
My intent would be to have some overlap so that there can be coordination of the transition. I think there's just so many moving parts at the nursing home. You can't just expect someone to walk in there on July 1st and be able to hit the ground running.
Okay, is that it for that item? Okay, next is the second item, which we added to the agenda, is financial update for the nursing home. Mr. Schneider.
For this item, I'd like to direct your attention to the handouts at your desk. In cooperation with the treasurer's office, Mr. Welch has provided you with a cash flow projection. It actually extends beyond the end of 2017, but I'm only brought through December on this sheet here. Based on updated numbers from Management Performance Associates, we've seen reductions in our payroll and also some reductions in our expenses. However, without any further assistance, we see our Nursing Home Enterprise Fund balance becoming negative by the end of June without any further assistance. This does not include the $250,000 previously authorized by the board. So if we were to, once we advance those funds, we expect that we should be able to get to September, which was what our original plan was, to be able to at least get to the next time when we would have a three payroll month in terms of our operations. There's a lot of ifs in this. One of the ifs is that MPA recommended budgeting about $100,000 per quarter in IGT money. As you know, that's a fairly erratic source of income. We did just get almost $200,000 in IGT money, but to expect it necessarily on a regular basis going forward, I think is a big if. We also are seeing challenges with our census. As of Monday, our census in the home is 139. So, as you know, it wasn't that long ago that we had almost 180 residents in the home. So we continue to see a dearth of new admissions to the home, while separations are continuing at a more normal pace. Yes, Ms. Petrie.
Do you know what percentage of those are now Medicaid, because that's a key variable for us?
I don't have the exact number right now, but when I last checked on it, I believe that the Medicaid number was fairly stable. So we had about 111 IPA residents. So the last calculation I did was we were at 75%. So if you take 111 out of 139, that's what I would say the percentage probably is right now.
Mr. Questions were important. I think if we're down to 111 Medicaid patients and 139, we're in a pretty drastic trajectory as far as the number of people in the nursing home. As we lose $80 a person on Medicaid, that means that the revenue, monthly revenue, is a real issue. We're losing $2,500 a day with the nursing home. Obviously, we know this is a major issue. And then when we look at these numbers and you discuss the $100,000, which we know that we were lucky enough to receive that $178,000, and we do have $250,000, the likelihood is we're not going to receive that. The comments are that we won't have a budget until probably a year and a half from now when we have a different governor, and which means that in August, as I look at this, where we have a negative $177,000 cash balance, means we actually have a negative $275,000 cash balance, if I'm reading this correctly. Does that make sense?
I'm sorry, could you say that again?
In August, your August line states that month we have, as read, it looks like $175,000 negative cash balance.
Correct, at the end of the month.
Right. But if we don't get the ITG money, that's actually a negative $275,000 cash balance. And even with our adding back in the $250,000 loan we gave the nursing home, we're losing $25,000. We're actually negative $25,000.
We could hit bottom sooner than September, of course. There is $100,000 budgeted for June to be coming in. Could happen in July or August also. It may not happen at all.
Of course, I'm building a picture here.
Yep.
Your monthly revenue here is stated at $875,000, and you have it static. I know you're trying to show what that is, but if our census is dropping so drastically, and that's what pays that revenue, it shouldn't be maintained at $875,000 through those 7 months. If April was 791, obviously by the time we get to September, it's going to be drastically smaller. We're not going to make more. We're not going to stay with the same amount of money by that point.
Yeah, I think that the point of the cash flow projection is to provide a snapshot. We know that these numbers can change going forward. This is where we're at right now if things stay the same. But, you know, there's a number of moving parts here also, so it's possible that we'll have financial problems earlier rather than later.
Right. Obviously, we're going into May, so and we looked at our general fund balance, and we just talked about how by 2021 we're going to have $3.5 million in the hole. And I'm wondering if we continue on this process and not change what we're doing, which we seem to be doing, and we get to that negative $768,000, where that's going to come from, what the impact will be on the general fund, and we were just discussing laying people off out of the general fund and out of the jobs in the county. And we're not even sure about these projected numbers. What would happen? And secondarily, if it got to the point where we closed the nursing home and had to pay the invoices that are listed here, and which I understand are $3 to $4 million, what that would do to the projected general fund balance, and it would likely double it, and what that would do to the number of jobs at this general at the county, let alone the care at the nursing home or the jobs at the nursing home. Maybe those questions are rhetorical, but if you want to respond to those, then I have another comment to make.
If we're at the point where we're talking about a closure, I think one of the scenarios contemplated that. I think it was scenario 3 when we talked about the nursing home previously. What I would recommend is if we get to a point where we're going to do that, I think that we would be in a position to issue debt. I think we would be able to say in good faith that we are exiting the business and that we would utilize levy funds to secure our debt
so that we could pay our obligations off without bankrupting general fund. As you remember, the scenario called for about 10 years worth of continuance of the operating levy. That would be in addition to the levy for the building bonds. So essentially the taxpayers would be expected to, you know, cover those costs going forward so that we wouldn't, you know, the county wouldn't go bankrupt.
Okay. Thank you. And I think we're all interested in options that would more favorably impact the nursing home. We discussed some last time, and one I would like to see pursued and give direction and ask for the rest of the board to give direction for the COW in May is to not only be pursuing the nonprofit option, but hiring the broker, the RFI that we had on the agenda before, and I would like, you know, a motion or the other support to put that on the agenda for the COW, to make sure that it's on the agenda for the COW for May 8th, so we can push that forward and ask the chairman about that, so we can.
We can do it in the form of a motion or just do a show of support by hands, too, like a straw vote. We can do like a straw vote, actually. Mr. Michael, are you done?
I can make further comments, but I'd like to hear the rest of the board make their comments.
Mr. Schneider to look to arrange for an RFI or an RFP?
I would recommend an RFI at this point. We're not required to use an RFP for this.
And all that means is we're looking for one. We're not necessarily hiring one. Does everybody understand that? If I can make one comment quick, could we also specify that person would look for a possible nonprofit entities part of it?
We were just talking about
nonprofit entities locally, but it could be on nonprofit entities outside of Champaign-Urbana, like certainly there's some in Chicago areas that might be interested.
Let me talk a little bit about what I've done so far. Since the last meeting, I drafted an RFI for your consideration. It's undergoing review by staff and also state's attorney's office to make sure we're in compliance with any applicable rules and regulations. Also, one of the things that has happened is that when I talked with that consultant yesterday, he brought up some issues that I thought might be appropriate to incorporate in the RFI ultimately, and we may actually want to include that person, whoever it is, to work with the county board when we get to the point of evaluating any sort of offers that might be presented to us. The RFI that I am drafting includes as one of the scope within the scope of services an item to work directly with the county board to identify the criteria that will be used in evaluating any kind of offer. So I think that to the chair's point about seeking out potential not-for-profit options, I think that would be how we would incorporate that into the RFI.
So go with Mr. Heiser first.
I have a feeling Ms. Cruz might be bringing up what I was going to bring up, social impact bonds. This is something that came up in caucus, another possible source of revenue to help support the nursing home. It's a new program, correct? I mean, you probably know more about it, Shana, but I think that's another. We're talking about options. This is an option I think that we should look into sooner rather than later as well.
Mr. Schneider, are you aware of these bonds?
I am not familiar with social impact bonds, so I need to do some research on that.
Okay, Ms. Let's go to Ms. Cruz quick.
To kind of build off of that, I think one thing that also came up in caucus was if we're going to go out for an RFI, we've discussed a lot of options. I would think of Mr. Maxwell's legacy as part of his facility work and really studying and looking at what our county has in terms of facilities, what our needs are, and what we should be doing going forward. So if we're going through the process of developing an RFI, it also would make sense maybe to include if there's anyone interested in Brookins, or if there'd be anyone interested in the downtown jail or any of the other properties that we've kind of identified as ones that we potentially would like to get off of our books, the old ILEAS building, stuff like that, and wondering if there could be like a bundle package so we can address our facility concerns and kind of in a comprehensive package versus just honing in on a couple.
You know, I think it's a great idea, and the kinds of advisors we potentially would bring in would have that expertise. Mm-hmm. So, and I personally would like to know, I mean, if we are ever to pursue sale of other properties, we're going to need to get appraisals done of those. So now might be a very good time to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Goss.
A nursing home specific question. We started the year at about 170 on census. We're down now below 140. Have we changed any, have we lowered our personnel? Have we cut back on any personnel? It didn't sound like it last time when Mr. Gima was here that we were still running a personnel census at some 220 plus.
Yeah, I think the primary efficiencies that have been gained so far have been eliminating over time. There's three people currently that were admitted to the hospital that we expect them to return to the home, so that will give a little lift to the census. Hopefully back up to 142, but, of course, by next week, who knows what will happen.
Further comments? Ms. Petrie.
A couple of thoughts that came out of caucus, building on what Mr. Heiser and Ms. Cruz have mentioned to you, and there's been a great deal of talk, exploratory talk, on the downtown jail and part of ILEAS and other properties, or even going from Brookins to downtown Urbana, which are all fantastic ideas, but I would hope out of those ideas, if and when we get this consultant and we have some idea what kind of money that would generate, how we can look at it in relationship to how then it can be used and the timeline. And my biggest concern in relationship to all of these steps, which are important, and we need this information to move forward as quickly as possible, but the generation of the extra income, I am very concerned when I look at these numbers and these negatives, the delay of it coming into it being an adequate resource for the nursing home. It may be an adequate resource for the facility issues that have been defined, and basically we have some idea of what that will be on an annual basis. But that's my concern, and that was still my concern in relationship to the use of the property tax, because there was still going to be a six-month delay before that money was realized, and that would almost have to be realized by taking out a loan before the property tax money came in. So as you work through these options to help us get a better judgment on a timeline of when potentially using some assumptions when some of these monies, if properties are sold, et cetera, will begin to come into play so we can see if there's any realistic way of stabilizing the home, or the way to stabilize the home and keep it alive and well, is to move forward and consider a sale. And I don't think I have all that sufficient information to make that kind of decision right at this moment.
Mm-hmm. I don't think we'd be in a position to issue debt unless we had some more definite decisions made about the disposition. I don't think that we'd be. I don't think we could do it in good faith. Is what I'm saying.
Further comments? Mr. Mitchell.
Just your basic daily operations at the nursing home. We've talked about vendors, and I'm curious, is everybody all willing to work with the county at this point so that we can maintain the service, medical services and food and all the all the other things that go along with the operations of a nursing home?
So far, that's been the case. Obviously, those positions could be somewhat tenuous, and it could change. But so far, everyone has been willing to hang in with us on our vendor list. We did have the one vendor that had been making noises about pursuing a lawsuit. They have not done so, to my knowledge. still working with us. So we're going to continue to try to work with our vendors. And I think the most important thing there is to make sure that they're informed about what we're doing. Obviously, no one wants to be in this position, and I think the best thing we can do is to let them know, you know, where we're at, so they can make their own decisions about what they're going to do. Some of the vendors have been very good working with us. I went to the home the other day and had lunch with some of the residents. Happy to say the food is much better than the last time I had been there, so I know that we had talked with our dietary vendor, and they have brought in some new management, and I believe there are improvements happening right now. So from that perspective, I think, you know, we could say that we relatively have a positive story with our vendors.
Mr. McGuire, do you have a comment? Okay, we'll go. All right, Ms. Petrie, you win.
Mine is very quick. I actually thought Max was going to make this comment. I heard him make it at the Champaign County Farm Bureau the other morning, and he was building on the comment that our county treasurer said, and it was sort of a acknowledgement that time is of the essence in our moving forward on a decision. I'm sorry.
I didn't cover that. Yeah. But, yeah, I think, you know, when we look at that, and also, I mean, it's pretty well demonstrated here that not doing anything and looking, you know, for the perfect solution is really going to be very detrimental to the future of the home, simply because as we move further into the year, our negative cash flow continues. And, you know, again, I think, and I've brought this up before, that, you know, families have this discussion around the kitchen table a lot, and trying to figure out what to do, how to make ends meet. And, you know, after the, I'm just frustrated that all the folks that in support of the nursing home did not stay to listen to the treasurer's report, and also how, you know, how the money and where the money comes from, and you know, the general revenue that's going to be coming in to support the nursing home. You know, we've hit that point of diminishing returns, and so time is of the essence. One quick comment about looking for a broker. What we're looking for is someone who is going to be selling a business that, an ongoing business, and then you're looking at selling buildings, basically, that are not going to have an ongoing business included with it. So I think, you know, in your search, you need to look for somebody who's going to specialize in that type of work. And I agree that we do need to trim down. And, you know, whatever we can trim away from the budget is good. But I think, you know, time is really of the essence for the nursing home being the primary issue that we look at today, and a broker that's going to facilitate the business, because they're going to have contacts. When you talk about a national search, they're going to have contacts in the national arena versus someone that's going to be selling an empty building.
Yeah, I appreciate any advice or expertise you can lend to my office in affecting this. One thing I was heartened by is that when I talked with the consultant yesterday, one of the things he suggested was that maybe we base part of the compensation on performance in terms of finding economies within our vendor contracts. I think without going into a lot of details, I think there's opportunities for reducing some of the costs. I know that last year when we looked at, we had that private valuation done on the home, and they analyzed the items on each line within the nursing home accounts. The evidence indicated many of the lines are well above statewide averages. So there may be some opportunities for improvement there to reduce the ongoing operating costs. Outside of just cutting staffing. The other thing I'm a little bit concerned about, I know that in the community I've heard some comments about, you know, this is something that maybe we can keep the home running for another 12 or 18 months. I think, you know, given the kind of numbers we're seeing here from the treasurer's office, we don't have half of that to work with. We're going to have to work as expeditiously as possible on all the options. So we're working on the RFI. One other thing we've done at the direction of the Nursing Home Advisory Board is I've met with the chair along with Kathy Emanuel to think about some of the proposed models that might work as an alternative to sale to a private company. We're working on setting up the meetings with people that or entities that might be able to work with the county on that. And now I'm hearing some other ideas here, which we ought to also take a look at. So I welcome all that information. There's going to be a lot of work that needs to be done, but I think we have to try and get it done right away. We just don't have time to wait. The longer we wait, the greater the risk grows that we will have a problem that we can no longer solve on our own, and the finances will solve it for us.
Mr. McGuire?
Okay. I guess I'll ask, just to make sure that it's on the agenda for the COW, that we make a motion to put the RFI on the agenda for the COW.
I think pretty clear you got that direction, Mr. Schneider.
I do.
Is there any objection to what Mr. Schneider's talked about tonight, any of the board members? Then I think we can proceed from there. You satisfied, Mr. McGuire?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Any last comments?
I think that's it.
All right. Is there any other business? Seeing none, we're adjourned.